Well, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, dear friends, thank you very much for joining us this morning. I'm Greg Scarlatoiu, Executive Director of the Committee for Human Rights in North Korea. I'm delighted to welcome all of you today, in particular Ambassador Robert King, Special Envoy for North Korean Human Rights, our co-chair emeritus of the board, Dr. Roberta Cohen, and all of our other most distinguished and dear friends who are in the audience today. This is a special day to HRNK. HRNK is an organization that has been tasked since 2001 to follow, to investigate, and to report on the North Korean human rights situation. While we know much more about North Korea than we knew 10 years ago or 15 years ago, it continues to be a very challenging environment. And always very difficult questions are asked. And this organization has embarked on a quest to answer or to provide some answers to those very difficult questions. HRNK has established its reputation as a research organization through the very good and hard work of our report authors. And we are always extraordinarily grateful to know that an expert of Ken Gause's caliber has authored not one, but two studies for HRNK. As you all recall, I'm sure, a little over 3 years ago, Ken Gause published for HRNK, Coercion, Control, Surveillance, and Punishment, a report addressing North Korea's internal security agencies. For the human rights expert and advocate, it's extraordinarily important to understand that mechanism of repression. We know that a question, that very important question that has been asked since the release of the report, of the UN Commission of Inquiry report in February of 2014, important questions have been asked pertaining to the issue of accountability. Who is responsible? What is the chain of command? What are the lines of responsibility? Ken Gause's new book, North Korean House of Cards, Leadership Dynamics under Kim Jong-un, answers many of the critical questions pertaining to North Korea's leadership, leadership dynamic under Kim Jong-un, and surely there is excellent information for the human rights expert, UN official, human rights advocate, interested in learning about the chain of command that I mentioned. Probably there will be no time to do this toward the end, so I'm going to do it now. All of those who have contributed, their names are included in the acknowledgement section. I'm sure that the author will acknowledge them. In particular, I would like to remind everyone that this book was fully produced in-house, including the graphic design and everything else, an extraordinary effort by my most talented colleagues, Rosa Park, Amanda Mortwood Oh, Raymond Ha, and all of the interns who have worked on this project. All of us have been extraordinarily grateful to know that we have the privilege of working with Ken Gause, and that's why I guess everyone went above and beyond their mission to complete their tasks. It goes without saying that our first speaker today is going to be the author himself. Ken Gause is a well-known, seasoned expert who has been concerned with areas such as North Korea, China, Iran, Syria, Russia. They're all hot spots, troubled spots today. Once again, it's extraordinary that Ken has continued to remain focused on North Korea and in particular on topics that are so relevant to human rights in North Korea. Ken Gause has produced numerous organizational studies on the leadership institutions associated, for example, with the Russian and North Korean ballistic missile programs. And in addition to the two books that he has published for HRNK, he also published, for example, for the Army War College's Strategic Studies Institute, his book, North Korean Civil Military Trends, Military First Politics to a Point, and also North Korea under Kim Jong-il, Power, Politics, and Prospects for Change, published by Prager in 2011. Ken, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Greg. I'd like to first start by expressing my profound appreciation to Greg and his team, without whose effort, in a Herculean effort at that, and patience on their part in terms of putting up with my interminable requests for just let me add in one more piece of information, or, oh, this person changed, let me add in another piece of information, which literally went on until about a week or two ago in terms of trying to keep this book as current as possible. So mentioning them by name, obviously Greg, Rosa Park, Amanda Mollett-Oh, who is one of the primary editors of the book, as well as the person who helped craft the executive summary, and I think she did a terrific job, which is very difficult to write executive summaries, by the way. And the interns, Madeline Perkerson, Raymond Ha, Brian Delamino, Suwon So, and Grace Wright, who all, as Greg said, took a lot of time, patience, and effort to make this book look as professional as possible. As I can tell you, the original copy that I sent in, draft copy, needed a lot of work in terms of both the editing as well as the polishing of the graphs and things like that. So let me talk a little bit about my background and my interests in North Korean leadership, which kind of led up to this study. Is I've been doing this really for 30-something years. I started off as a Sovietologist working for the U.S. government, doing criminology and understanding how Kremlin decision-making worked in Moscow back in the early 1980s. But really, since about 1988 or so, I started to focus on North Korea, because at that time there was not a whole lot of people that were focusing on North Korea, much less on the North Korean leadership. And when I came into the National Press Club today, I was riding on the metro, and we were all jammed together on the metro there. And as some of the people kind of walked out, I had a chance to kind of look around at some of the people that were standing next to me, and who should be standing there, I think, I'm not positive, but I think, was Carl Bernstein. And why do I say this? Carl Bernstein, obviously one of the authors of All the President's Men. And in that book, and in the movie that was made later on, it makes it clear that when you look at any sort of governing institution, but especially when you talk about a totalitarian or authoritarian regime, we need to understand it from the human level. Because at the end of the day, decision making in any country comes down to individuals. We can look at countries from a state level and try to project what they're going to do because of national interests. And a lot of times, especially with a country like North Korea, we ended up left scratching our head trying to figure out why the heck are they doing that? It just can't be in their national interest. But when you start to get down to the human level and start to look at the inner dynamics within the regime and how various individuals operate against each other, it begins to start to make some sense. And so therefore, when I talk to people about how to understand a country like North Korea, I tell students that I have and anybody else who will listen to me is don't study IR theory. It's not going to tell you anything about what you need to know and understand about how North Korea operates. You need to watch soap operas. And you need to watch things like I, Claudius, where you can really kind of understand where you have an individual or a group of individuals that operate inside of a bubble around a supreme leader or a dictator or an emperor, and how dynamics play out within that inner circle, and then how they are eventually translated into national policy. And it's can be a very bizarre process. But unless you understand, and unless you approach trying to understand a country at that level, especially, I would argue, a totalitarian regime, you're going to miss a lion's share of what's going on and the motivations and intentions of regimes. So in terms of this book, Greg and I got together, I guess it was a couple years ago, where Greg asked me whether I'd be interested in doing a book. And he had suggested that he would like something done on the evolving leadership dynamics under Kim Jong-un, the organizational structure and the key players involved in the royal economy, or that part of the economy that is tied to the Kim family, and the key individuals in North Korea tied to the gulag or political prison system. And so I went off to do my research and quickly found out that that third point about the gulag was just going to be a bridge too far given the funding and the time available to be able to really drill down to that level in understanding the dynamics of how the gulag feeds into the violation of human rights and other things. Maybe that's a book for the future at some point. So I went off and started focusing on the first two parts of the paper, and then of course in December of 2013, you had the purge and the execution of Chiang Son-taek. And this was a profound moment in terms of this book. It really turned everything upside down. All I can say is thank God it happened in 2013 and not 2015, because the profound impact that it has on everything related to this book, in terms of individuals who are in various places within the regime, in terms of what we understand about the decision-making dynamics within the regime, in terms of creating a model in which we can understand this regime. But it also had a profound impact on my last book, on the police state in North Korea, because Chiang Son-taek oversaw the Central Committee's Administrative Department, which is in charge of the internal security apparatus inside North Korea. And so now I had to go back and start to reformulate how the internal security apparatus looked and operates. And so I went to Greg and talked to him about, why don't we make that the third section of the book, which would be basically updating the critical elements of my last book on the internal security apparatus. So basically what we have in this book is a book that is divided into two parts. The first part is dealing with the leadership dynamics within the regime. And in that part of the book, what I am trying to set out is basically a model by which to understand the North Korean regime. And there are several models that are out there right now. There are three major models on how to understand North Korean regime. And if you subscribe to one or the other model, all of your assumptions are going to be impacted. How you think this regime operates will be impacted. The first model deals with Kim Jong-un is the unassailable supreme leader, was the unassailable supreme leader since day one, since his father died on December 17, 2011, just because of the nature and the culture of the regime. And this would argue that he is basically the ultimate decision maker, unchallenged, and so therefore he is pretty much ready to be the supreme leader from day one and has completely stepped into the role of that position and holds the power that his father and grandfather held. The second model really kind of came out in full force after the execution of Chiang Son-taek, and it's the model that basically Kim Jong-un is so inexperienced that he is being manipulated behind the scenes. And of course, there is the famous book that came out about a year or so ago, which really makes the argument that basically it's the Organization Guidance Department, the powerful Central Committee Department that's in charge of surveillance within the regime, that is really kind of playing things behind the scenes and really kind of manipulating policy and manipulating Kim Jong-un. And then the third model, which is the model that this book is based on, the one that I believe, is that Kim Jong-un is the supreme leader, he is the ultimate decision maker, but he has not consolidated his power. And how do I describe what the consolidation process is? And again, you need to step back and you need to think about this from the point of view of human beings and what would have to happen for somebody to completely step into the shoes of a supreme leader. And two things really kind of emerged out of this thought process and in my discussions with a lot of Pyongyang watchers in the region who are following this thing very closely and have for years. Many of them are part of the network that I have that helps me collect information on the leadership. And we came to the conclusion that there are two major things that you need to do. Well, there are a couple of sets of things you need to do, but we'll start off with the kind of the basic human element of the thing that you need to do in order to consolidate your power. One, you need to develop relationships inside the regime that allow you to be able to control power and manipulate power and enforce your will on the regime, not only through formal channels, but also through informal channels. And this is basically a relationship building exercise. And this takes us back to the idea that Kim Jong-un was most likely he has not had the time that his father had to grow into this role of supreme leader. You know, his father entered the Central Committee apparatus in 1964. He became the heir apparent really inside the regime in 1974. He became the formal heir apparent at the Sixth Party Congress in 1980. And then, of course, he took over the National Defense Commission and became the Supreme Commander in the early 90s. And then, of course, 30 years after he entered the Central Committee apparatus, in 1994, Kim Il-sung dies. Kim Jong-il, who by that time was really running the regime, the day-to-day operations, and had really since the 1980s, had built all of these relationships, and he developed a kind of what we call hub-and-spoke management style, which was pretty much run along informal lines. During the period of the Kim Jong-il period, the party apparatus pretty much became dilapidated. The Politburo didn't meet. Other senior bodies didn't meet on a regular basis. The way that policymaking was done was a very personal level, in which Kim Jong-il, working with small groups of people in these kind of midnight parties that they would have and discuss policy, and he would work through his personal secretariat to basically work out options about how the regime would move forward. But it was very clear that Kim Jong-il called all the shots and that everybody else basically was in charge of executing his will. Well, Kim Jong-un most likely was chosen to be the supreme leader or be the heir apparent in the days after Kim Jong-il's stroke in August of 2008. In September, there was supposedly a private meeting between Kim Jong-il, Kim Kyung-hui, his sister, Chang Son-taek, and maybe Kim Jong-un, in which it was decided at that point that Kim Jong-un would be made the heir apparent. There had been an apparent succession process put in place by Kim Jong-il's mistress, Ko Hyung-hui, Kim Jong-un's mother, in the early 2000s, which eventually petered out after she died of breast cancer in Paris in 2004. And then Kim Jong-il basically closed down the whole succession process because he did not want to create another center of power within North Korea. But after his stroke, it became very obvious that he was not going to live forever. And then he started to put the process together. So Kim Jong-un, chosen most likely because of his personality traits, his older brother Kim Jong-chol, the one that we see at Eric Clapton concerts and things, apparently didn't have what it takes to be a supreme leader or didn't have an interest in being the supreme leader. Kim Sol-song, who is Kim Jong-un's older half-sister, and apparently Kim Jong-il's favorite offspring, the only offspring that was recognized by Kim Il-sung himself, very astute political actor inside the North Korean regime, because of course, because of the culture and her gender, that probably kept her out of the race to become the supreme leader. That fell, obviously, to Kim Jong-un. So if we imagine, you know, that Kim Jong-un being basically tag, you're it, in 2008, and of course, January 2009, the Organization Guidance Department begins to put out the word that Kim Jong-un is now the heir apparent. He has a very limited amount of time, basically about 2 years, before his father dies, and he is really then has to begin to run the process of becoming supreme leader. Obviously, there is not enough time to develop the relationships. And the other thing that he needs to do besides that is to really understand how to manipulate the levers of power inside of North Korea. And it is a very complex series of levers of power and how you manipulate various individuals and patronage systems and things like that in order to enforce your will along informal lines. So right after the death of Kim Jong-il, there were two meetings that were set up on a weekly basis, generally a weekly basis, on Tuesdays and Fridays, for Kim Jong-un to be able to then begin to develop the relationships and understand the manipulation of levers of power. The first one on Tuesday was basically focused on domestic politics and domestic policy, and there would be a lot of people who were directly involved across the regime who would be in that meeting and providing input on the day-to-day policies of domestic policy. The other one was on Friday, and that was the day in which foreign and security policy was held. That was organized by Kim Kyung-hui herself. And the interesting thing is that neither one of these meetings included Chung Sung-taek, and that was done on purpose because Chung Sung-taek, who was the control tower within the regime, and control tower is a term used by Pyongyang watchers to talk about the person who runs the day-to-day operations of the regime. And Chung Sung-taek was basically, we believe, operating in that role early on in the Kim Jong-un era. And he was working with the various issue groups inside North Korea to develop policy and then talking with Kim Jong-un about the various policy options. And so also within these meetings on Tuesday and Friday, you had the chance, Kim Jong-un had the chance to meet a variety of people across the regime, both inside Pyongyang and outside Pyongyang, who would be critical for executing policy. So in this way, as we start to think about it, this was the way that North Korea kind of came up with educating Kim Jong-un on how to run the regime. Not necessarily decision-making bodies, but helping him understand all of the things that were involved in the policy realm. In other studies that I've done, you know, for example, on Syria and looking at Bashar al-Assad, he had a very different way to how he developed his style. And there's not time to go into it, but it was very different than what we see in North Korea. So what it really suggests is that the regime has to come up with a way of educating a supreme leader, which then suggests that he is not entirely ready, even though he has all the titles of power from the very beginning or very early on, first secretary of the party, first chairman of the National Defense Commission, head of the Central Military Committee. But he still needs to learn how to operate the regime. And so that was basically the beginning of my model of how to think about this regime. And of course, early on in this regime, he also had a regent structure surrounding him, made up of Kim Kyung-hui, Chung Sung-taek, and Chae Long-hae, who eventually at that time became the director of the General Political Bureau, basically enforcing loyalty within the military. And these were the people that were the closest to Kim Jong-un at the time. Now also, there was another set of things that Kim Jong-un had to do in order to consolidate his power. And if we look at him today, he has done two of the three things. The first thing he needed to do was conduct politics inside the regime, and that means purging people and moving people around and basically bending the regime to his will and bringing the people into the regime who would be critical for him to be able to run the regime in the future along the lines that he wanted to run it. And he has done a remarkable job at this basically playing politics inside the regime. We believe probably with a lot of advice by Kim Jong-un early on in his administration, she was probably providing the advice. As one of the regents, she was in charge of basically protecting the Kim family equities within the regime because she was obviously the daughter of Kim Il-sung, the purest of the pure blood, and somebody who probably had veto power over decision-making in the regime, with the exception of decisions made by Kim Jong-un himself. So she would be able, and given the many decades that she had spent at the top of the regime and all of the people that she was involved with and having one of the most extensive patronage systems inside the regime, she would be in a great position to be able to help him understand and navigate the complex Byzantine labyrinth of politics inside North Korea. And we saw this on display with early on in June of 2012 with the removal of Lee Young-ho, who was the powerful chief of the general staff, the person who had been really promoted at the 10th, at the third party conference in 2010, in which he really kind of became a very powerful figure. And many people believed at the beginning of the Kim Jong-un era that the military would basically run roughshod over this 30-year-old kid, and he would be basically nothing more than a puppet. Well, Lee Young-ho was removed in June of 2012, and there was very little reverberations inside the regime, to the point that when I went to China later on that year and was talking to a lot of their Pyongyang watchers about what China's views of stability inside the regime were, that they said that, look, the fact that he could take out the powerful chief of the general staff and the regime would not be toppled or, you know, would not cause chaos inside the regime, that gave them a level of confidence to then believe that they did not have to deal with the Kim Jong-un regime with kid gloves like they were originally going into it, that they could take a tougher line against North Korea. So anyway, so that was conducting politics inside the regime. The second thing that he needed to do was to show progress on the critical weapons systems. And a lot of people, and I know a lot of people in the U.S. government were frustrated with the missile test in April of 2012. But if you think about it from Kim Jong-un's point of view, he had one of the critical things that he needs to do is to show that he has control and he is paying proper deference to the security of the nation. And so that April 2012 test of the missile or the satellite system, whatever you want to call it, the ICBM test, that failed, and remarkably enough, North Korea admitted that it failed, was done primarily, that was a decision that was most likely made under Kim Jong-il and was needed to happen in order for the consolidation process to go forward. He could not ignore the critical defense systems. He had to show himself not only as a leader who has all the power, but he also has to have a person who has the interest of the powerful elements within the regime, namely the military. And so in December of 2012, you had the quote-unquote successful test of an ICBM. And then, of course, in February of 2013, you had the third nuclear test. And so he has pretty much checked the box on that, at least for now. And then the third thing that he needed to do, but he has not done, and this is critical, and this goes to the heart of the model that I've developed, is that he has to show progress on the economy. If you remember his first speech, he talked about the no longer to have the need for belt tightening, which of course is coded language inside North Korea about some sort of economic measures that need to be taken. Of course, in the summer of 2012, the economic measures came out, but of course have never really been executed in a way that I think the regime was planning on doing that, because a lot of that is tied into bringing in economic aid from the outside world. And of course, with the announcement of the Byungjin policy of the co-development of the nuclear program and the economy. He has basically put himself into a catch-22 position. He has pushed himself into a corner in which he cannot get the international aid that he needs in order to consolidate his power, because he is not willing to trade on the nuclear program, because that is critical to his legitimacy as the leader. He has put himself in a pretty much untenable position. And I would argue that that the diplomatic charm campaign that we saw after, you know, the end of the March-April crisis of 2013, in which North Korea ramped up the tension on the peninsula, and then you had that go into a diplomatic charm campaign. You had the reaching out to Seoul, you've had the reaching out to Japan, you've had the reaching out to Russia. All of that has not worked. And of course, then you had the August crisis in just a couple of months ago, which could indicate that the regime may be shifting its policy toward a more brinksmanship and aggressive policy in order to try to reset the table and lay the groundwork for bringing in international aid. So basically, as we go through and look at the first section of the book that deals with the leadership dynamics in some of these policies that are being made, we have to also take into account the critical thing that fits in the middle of all of this, and that's the execution of Chung Sung-taek. Why would you take out and permanently purge probably the number two person in the regime, even though really in all truthfulness, there is one person who's the head of the regime, that's Kim Jong-un, and there is no number two. But when Chung Sung-taek was around, there was suggestion that there was somebody who, if in terms of having the extensive patronage system, in terms of the ability to affect policy and things, Chung Sung-taek was a major player. And I think that the story, at least, that began to come out in my discussions with defectors and people in the region who know a lot and watch these things very closely, is that it began in 2012. And in August 2012, Chung Sung-taek was sent to China to basically talk about the new Kim Jong-un regime, carry the best wishes of the supreme leader to the Chinese leadership, also talk about the special economic zones and the economic relationship that was growing between China and North Korea. There was also a secret mission that was part of that trip, and that mission was, I believe, to get the money out of the Chinese banks that belonged to the Kim family. And for some reason, that did not happen. Whether that was Chung Sung-taek's somewhat incomplicit agreement with the Chinese leadership not to basically withhold the funds from the Kim family, or whether it was China saying, no, you cannot have the money. For some reason, Chung Sung-taek did not come back with the funds. And what I argue in the book, which again is speculative and is a theory, is that that began to introduce the seed of doubt about Chung Sung-taek and his control, or his faith in Chung Sung-taek, and Kim Jong-un's faith in Chung Sung-taek as a supporter. So when you had Kim Kyung-hui, who we believe had a stroke sometime in 2012, that led to an investigation, which of course revealed a lot of stuff about Chung Sung-taek in terms of empire building within the regime that led to his eventual purge and execution. So anyway, that then really begins to help us understand about the resiliency of this regime. First, its ability to sustain a hit such as the removal of the number two person in the regime, but also to begin to understand about, okay, now Kim Jong-un really has to begin to run this regime on his own. The regent structure goes away, and he is now basically running the regime through a variety of different advisors and things, which I discuss in the book, and I go at great length to talk about a lot of these individuals. The second part of the book is dealing with the royal economy and the internal security apparatus and Kim Jong-un's personal apparatus of power. And there I spend a lot of time talking about, you know, the organizational structure that he has placed around him, his personal secretariat, which is growing, be able to accommodate his role as the control tower. I talk about the role of Kim Yo-chong, his younger sister, who is growing in that as a contributor to that apparatus, as well as the highly speculative argument that I have, which is that his older half-sister, Kim Sol-song, is also involved in that apparatus. And that this talks about an apparatus that is really kind of controlling his day-to-day affairs and how he runs the regime. Then I talk about the royal economy, and basically here the argument is the royal economy, in order for him to consolidate his power, he is having to spend more and more money in order to build largesse within the elite inside North Korea, yet at the same time the royal economy is bringing in less and less money because of a drying up of a lot of illicit trafficking networks, because of a lot of the networks that they were using for hard currency operations are drying up, and things like that. So basically he needs to bring more money in order to buy the largesse, but he's having trouble doing that, which then makes that need for the international aid even more important for him to be able to consolidate his power. And so you're getting a regime that is now becoming under stress. And the third part obviously deals with the internal security apparatus, which of course, following the collapse of Chung Sun-taek, you've had a major restructuring of the security apparatus, and now a lot of the lines and the chains of command are now coming up directly to Kim Jong-un. We're seeing a lot of crackdowns inside the regime in order to build and hold on to stability in the regime. And then finally, when you kind of put it all together here, my final conclusion is, and this is based on a lot of discussions in the region, is that, you know, the next 2 to 5 years are going to be very critical for this regime. Kim Jong-un really needs to consolidate his power within that time frame, because if he does not consolidate his power, things will begin to happen inside the regime. Thresholds will be passed, which will make it increasingly difficult for him to consolidate his power. And I'm not saying that the regime is going to collapse in 2 to 5 years, although that's a possibility if some other things begin to happen, but it can make it very difficult for the regime to operate as a sarong-based system, which is basically a top-down leader-based system. It will have to transform into something else where there will be other voices at the center of power that may have some influence, much more influence than they have now. And then basically you have moved into a system in which the culture of North Korea and politics will have a great difficulty in supporting. And that, of course, can then have a long-term cascading effect, which then may eventually lead to the collapse of the regime somewhere down the line. But again, it's impossible to make any predictions along those lines. And of course, you have just today, the North Korean press announcing the 7th Party Congress that will happen next May, which of course will make a lot of this book OBE by that time, because you're going to probably have massive turnover in personnel. But that can be an indication in that the regime is moving quickly toward the final steps in the consolidation process, at least formally. The question is, informally, can Kim Jong-un actually pull it off? And it's something we're going to have to see. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ken. Before I give the floor to our distinguished discussants, I would also like to welcome Jack Rendler, Amnesty International, former HRNK board member. I should also have acknowledged the contributions of my good friend Nick Miller, who was Ken's research assistant. His father, Dr. Miller, is here with us today. Thank you very much for joining us. Our first discussant is Professor David Maxwell, Associate Director of the Center for Security Studies and the Security Studies Program at Georgetown University. He has been tremendously helpful to HRNK. Whenever we call him, he drops everything he's doing and places HRNK at the very top of his list of priorities. And for that and many other reasons, the Board of Directors unanimously voted in September of this year to elect him as our newest board member. We are delighted that he's on the board. This organization has been only targeted by cyber attacks, but now we know that we are absolutely safe. We have a strong deterrent. Professor Maxwell led organizations from Special Forces A teams to the Joint Special Operations Task Force level, and he did retire as a 30-year veteran of the U.S. Army, retiring as a Special Forces Colonel before joining the faculty of Georgetown University. Dave, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Greg, and it is a great honor to be part of this great organization. And one of the reasons I'm so honored is because of this report and so many others like it. And so I commend HRNK and I commend Ken for a really fantastic book. But Ken, you had me worried when you started out. You invoked Woodward and Bernstein and all the president's men. I thought you were going to request another change and change the title to All the Kim Family Regime's Men, which I'm glad you're not, because I think House of Cards is an apt title. And as you've laid out in your book, and we can really see what the Kim family regime is all about. You know, it is a mafia-like crime family cult. And I think your description of decision-making and the power politics and the transition is spot on. I completely agree that Kim Jong-un has had to consolidate power. He is in charge, but you know, he's got to work through all the problems that you've outlined. The second thing that worried me was I fear that our graduate students will hear you say, don't study IR theory. So I hope that's edited out. But you are correct, and I do agree that studying or that watching dramas, particularly Korean dramas, can be very helpful to understanding the regime in the North and what the regime in the North is doing to the Korean people who live in the North. I think that's very important. And again, one of the reasons why I'm happy to be associated with HRNK is the focus on the Korean people living in the North and their rights and the atrocities that are being committed by the Kim family regime. But you mentioned that you have to take a human approach to this, and I think that is very important. We've got to understand the human dynamics. And one of the things that we've learned, or some people have learned in the last 14 years in the security community, is an emphasis on the importance of the human domain. And so your report and your book really fits into understanding the human domain as it exists among the Kim family regime and the Korean people living in the North. You know, there's something in this book for everyone. As Ken has laid out, you know, of course, the transition from Kim Jong-il to Kim Jong-un. You know, he's talked about the purge of Jongsong-tek and how important that is. The royal economy, things like fear politik, gift politik. I like those terms, and I plan to use them in my research. And of course, the security services, the organization and guidance department, which I don't think is emphasized enough. And then other things like Department 39 and 38, all the illicit activities the regime is conducting around the world. You know, this book is very readable, and I commend everyone to read it, but it is also useful as a reference and something to study. And even if the party Congress happens and there are changes to the leadership, you know, while leaders change, I think the Kim family regime will continue to function. And all of your descriptions of the security services, the royal economy, and the dynamics will stand the test of time for as long as the Kim family regime continues to exist. And so I've been waiting for this to be published so I can cite it. And now that it is out there, there is much in this book that is useful to researchers, and I plan on using much of it, and I commend everyone else to do so as well. Now, this book is important because it's useful now for policymakers. It's also useful to think about how it can support unification. Ultimately, unification, my belief is that the only way we'll see an end to the nuclear program, as well as the crimes against humanity that are being perpetrated against the Korean people living in the North, is through unification. I think one of the points that Ken makes in the book is that reform, trying to reform, even though we have Byung-jin and they talk about economic reforms. To truly reform in North Korea will most likely lead to regime collapse, which is one of the four ways I would, the four pathways I see to unification. Of course, the most important one, peaceful unification, the one we'd all like, but I think it's unlikely as long as the Kim family regime exists that they are likely to seek peaceful unification. Of course, the worst one is war, so collapse is the third. There is a fourth one, and this book contributes to this, and this is an understanding of how the regime works and the potential for resistance among second-tier leaders and even the general population. But if you think that there is a potential for resistance, you have to understand the security services. You have to understand the oppression mechanisms that the Kim family regime imposes on the Korean people living in the North. This book will be useful to security practitioners, to non-governmental organizations, and when you combine it with the other works from HRNK on Songbun, on the political prison camps, Ken's earlier work that this builds on, all of those together combine to give us greater understanding of the human domain in North Korea and help policymakers and strategists and those practitioners on the Korean Peninsula and throughout the international community who are going to have to deal with the fallout of the eventual change in the regime when it happens in the North. Although it is the leadership and the annex on leadership is perishable because, as you mentioned, changes are likely to occur, again, I think the descriptions are very important. Your analysis is very important. And the one suggestion I would make would be to take that annex in the book and to have an online interactive tracking of the leaders, you know, both as they change, as they're purged, and as they are rehabilitated and come back to power. But I think that would be a good follow-on project to maintain an up-to-date database, which I think an evolving database would still it would keep this report very relevant because the procedures, the processes, the way the regime functions, I think will continue to function that way as long as the regime exists. So I think this book is very important. I commend it to everybody. I will use this. I think scholars, practitioners, researchers will make great use of it, and I commend Ken and HRNK for writing and publishing this. I'll stop there.
It is an extraordinary privilege that Dr. Patrick Cronin has joined the other most distinguished speakers today. He is a very well-known expert in Asian Pacific security, U.S. defense, foreign and development policy. I think that his presence here today and the help and assistance he kindly extends to HRNK is testament that we have really come a long way as human rights organizations, and this is really an issue that has continued to gain traction next to the other very important issues, political security issues of grave concern related to North Korea. Dr. Cronin is a senior advisor and senior director at the Asia Pacific Security Program at the Center for a New American Security. Previously, he was the senior director of the Institute for National Security Strategy at the National Defense University, where he simultaneously oversaw the Center for the Study of Chinese Military Affairs. He has edited and authored numerous articles, reports, and many other publications. Dr. Cronin, the floor is yours.
Greg, thank you very much. And you certainly have come a long way as an organization, and the publication of this book, I think, amply demonstrates that. It's a wonderful contribution that will have, a long shelf life because it is so encyclopedic. And I just want to make five quick points that will partly cover points that have already been made. But the first one is I have to talk about the popular cultural reference to House of Cards, even though I know he's using Merriam-Webster's dictionary in the front, you know, to try to isolate it from Hollywood, I think.
But the reality is that the House of Cards, the HBO series, is instructive here in the sense that things are never quite what they appear to be in North Korea. And there's always deception and cunning. And Machiavelli looks like a liberal Western theorist, you know, in comparison to North Korea. And that's sort of the human rights dimension here, which is to say, you know, one of the not so well kept secrets out of North Korea is the misery of the people of North Korea that go on every day but go underreported because we don't really have the kind of access to them that we have to the photos of Kim Jong-un or the top level leadership. And that's what's not to be forgotten here, and your organization is helping not to forget that, and Ken's exhaustive research is helping to give us multiple layers, the four echelons, the whole Kim family, and it's filling in, you know, it's connecting the dots and filling in the picture and giving us a three-dimensional understanding of North Korea that has is still lacking in even elite circles in Washington, I would say. And I really want to talk about the other four points related to U.S. policy in a way. This is an important book because it helps American decision makers and others get into the decision-making loop of North Korea. North Korea, arguably, is already in the American policy decision-making loop. I'll give you one very small anecdote that's very self-serving and personal, but a good friend of mine was on a plane in Mongolia last week, and he was sitting next to a North Korean official. The North Korean official had been reading the duty-free catalog of cognac and put that down, and he picked up something I wrote. He had his Kim Il-sung lapel pin on. You know, this was an official who was well-connected, and he's reading my analysis of not North Korea, but of U.S. policy in Asia. And I'm just thinking, yes, they are inside our decision-making loop. And I think even the recent Pak-Obama summit gives you a hint of that. This is my personal take on that summit, but talking to U.S. officials on this as well, you did have a sense that the summit was even better prepared had there been a provocation like a missile launch than it was without the provocation. So in the absence of a provocation, Kim Jong-un did not oblige the alliance in the timing. And I know one WAG has said, if you ever want to make sure that the North Koreans don't launch, just give them the date on which they are going to launch. And that's the date that they will definitely not launch a missile. But the serious point here is getting inside the decision-making loop. If we're going to influence their human rights policy, their nuclear policy, their missile policy, are going to have even any a chance to influence them or to stay ahead with thinking about eventually a soft landing in the whole bonanza of unification that President Park Geun-hye has talked about, then we're going to have to get inside the decision-making loop, and this book starts to help us peel back the layers of the onion and beyond the few officials who are responsible, who know all, you know, how narrow the apparatus is within the U.S. government, to try to understand the complexity of North Korea, because it isn't just one leader, even if it is the top-down system that Ken explained so well. So understanding the personal secretariat and getting in the agenda setting, you know, the calendar setting, literally, of the supreme leader is very important, it seems to me. So if we're going to get a soft landing, this book is important. If we're going to prepare for a hard landing, this book is equally important. Talking to a general yesterday with great responsibilities for North Korean collapse scenarios, and he was reminding me, unprovoked, that miscalculation remains, from him, a very scary, a very realistic possibility on the Korean Peninsula. Indeed, I've written a separate piece that will be out soon that talks about the two most likely ways that you could have sudden change in North Korea. One of them is miscalculation, like the landmine incident in August, but suddenly escalating. Another one would be a palace coup, an assassination, top-down, because the seeds are not yet sown for a more bottom-up kind of resistance movement that Dave has talked about, which is possible in the future, but probably not in the near term. But as information seeps in, as markets maybe are created, licitly or not, that is another scenario. And then, of course, the soft landing seems a very, very remote possibility at this point, given the system and the structure. If we are going to be prepared for no landing, the book is still very important. And no landing is the world we continue to live in. So it's very difficult. Nobody is predicting, and I think Ken is not predicting any forecast of collapse, he said, in 2 to 5 years. But being a critical window on which change has to be monitored so closely, because this consolidation question, and experts I know argue over the word consolidation, and there are friends of mine inside the government who swear that he's consolidated power. I don't think it's a contradiction to say that on the one hand, Kim Jong-un has made huge strides towards consolidating power. I mean, he's the fear politique alone, the purges, what he's been able to accomplish in this period, and Ken Gause's book talks about how in mid-2013, there was very debatable whether Kim Jong-un had the military behind him. He's clearly intimidated the military to a much larger extent in late 2015 than he had in 2013. But that's not to say that he's not highly, in a highly tenuous position. The miscalculation and assassination are, again, maybe the two most possible ways that he might be bumped off. But the point is that he is has to be increasingly watchful, if not paranoid, about everything about him. He's created more enemies than friends, even if the gifts are still coming. And that whole economic side of it, by the way, going back to the levers of power and looking at Bill over here, I mean, thinking about the $4 billion that possibly the two offices were raising outside, the whole revenue stream of the royal economy. But you actually delineate, I don't know, it must be 25 different parts of the government. And the government is one big mafia state or state-owned enterprise. And every one of them is going out to find their profit, you know, to find the level of profit that they need to bring in. And some of it may be reported, some of it may be under the table, so the corruption issue. I mean, just this is the kind of detail that we're going to need to try to manipulate North Korea back toward the comity of nations, to deal with human rights in a way that we expect them to be dealt with, the way that they're dealt with in the Republic of Korea, in the United States, in most of the world. One dimension that's missing from all this, perhaps that's very new, is the cyber dimension, and something I've been thinking a lot about lately, because I think both for illicit economy, you talk about how, for instance, missile and defense sales, by all accounts, are indeed down far below what they were 10 years ago. And they've gone into other illicit business. But it seems to me that the cyber crime business, the cyber data destruction business, as in Sony, and the cyber kinetic action business, which we may see in the future, are parts of this regime apparatus that might really appeal to this particular young supreme leader, and we wonder about that. But tremendous contribution. So I just think this is a great start for anybody to deepen thinking about who's doing what and might do what inside North Korea. So thank you.
Thank you very much. Patrick, thank you very much. We're now ready for our Q&A session. I would like to remind you that the event is being recorded. Please wait for the microphone before answering the question, before asking the question. We have two mic runners. If possible, please also state your name and affiliation. And unless you're addressing the question to all three panelists, please remember to specify to whom you are addressing the question. Yes, sir, Greg, please, and then I'll go to Chad O'Carroll.
I'm Greg Stanton. I'm the president of Genocide Watch and also a professor of genocide studies over at George Mason University. I was also the person who drafted the UN resolutions that created the Rwandan Tribunal, and I'm the man behind the Cambodian Tribunal. I wrote the rules for that. So I look at this thing and this wonderful book as a prosecutor's manual. Chapter 3 absolutely gives you the list of the people who ought to be prosecuted. And your Appendix 12 also details that list. Interestingly enough, in this case, South Korean courts under the South Korean Constitution actually have jurisdiction to try these people because the South Korean courts consider Korea one. I just wanted to get your response to that. I know that's post change, if you will, but you know, you can actually indict somebody before the change. And I think indicting Milosevic had a huge impact in his downfall. I'm just wondering if you think the South Korean government might politically be willing to go forward with something like this, because it is a very, of course, aggressive act.
Thank you. My feeling is, and again, it's just an impression, is that South Korea right now is in a very difficult situation, because the solution to getting at the North Korean situation, in my opinion, is yes, you can take a very aggressive action and put all these people on trial, or threaten to put all these people on trial. But in the near term, that means that this regime is going to double down, and it probably is going to feed into a very aggressive posture in the region. I think right now there is probably a debate going on in Seoul circles about how to think about, you know, if ultimately we want to have the reunification that that David talked about, and preferably something of a soft landing. I think the only way that you're going to get at that is through some sort of an engagement with North Korea at some point in the future. I don't think politically it makes a lot of sense right now inside Washington or in Seoul to be able to do that. But at some point there is going to be the reckoning that this regime will have to go through. But it will be post-collapse in some sort, or post-unification. And some of these individuals very well. I mean, many of them do have blood on their hands, especially people in the security apparatus and some other places, even some parts of the party apparatus. That's how you manage to basically establish your bona fides within in the regime, especially with certain aspects of the regime. The interesting thing, though, and this is something that I am working on now, is that there is another group of people that are evolving and emerging behind the scenes that we don't really know a whole lot about right now. These people are fairly young. They're in their 30s, 40s. They're kind of the generation of Kim Jong-un. Many of these people now populate his personal secretariat. And there is a good chance that these people have a different view of how things should operate. They have rising expectations of wanting to be connected to the outside world, or at least enjoy the benefits of the outside world. I mean, one of these the bizarre things that we always talk about is, why in the heck would you build a ski slope? Or this big swimming pools and stuff. Why you know, you spend all this money and feed your people? Well, part of the reason is that Kim Jong-un, there is a subset of the elite that he needs to appeal to, and he needs to give them things to, you know, show some sort of rise in expectations within the regime. He needs to satisfy that. It'll be interesting to see, I think, in the future, if whether as these people get established, and maybe at the 7th Party Congress, we may begin to see some of these people, but probably they're still too young to be appointed to the senior positions. Whether these people actually start to drive the regime toward, you know, pressure toward a direction that we would like them to go. And then as Patrick was talking about, and I talk about in my book, that this regime is not structured to deal with reform. And so you're gonna create this incredible churn inside this regime that could make this ultimately a very, very dangerous situation. But I think that you're right, you know, once all of this settles, the dust settles, either through a collapse or reunification, that there will need to be a reckoning. And possibly, hopefully, that this book will identify some of the people that at least need to consider about, you know, what they have done in the past. And whether they do have blood on their hands, or whether they're people that are just trying to get by and, you know, doing their job within the regime. It'll be something that we would have to work out. It's a good question, though.
I would just add to that, and I agree with Ken. South Korea is in a difficult position now, but your points have great merit. And I think as part of a deliberate strategy to try to influence the behavior of the regime, that it could be useful, especially if we combined it with other activities to target Department 39 around the world. There are illicit activities, but I think it's really important along the lines of the Commission of Inquiry, the UN Commission of Inquiry, and the impact that has made, or we think has made, on Kim Jong-un, and that he's taken that as a real affront. And so I think indictment of criminals in the North could be useful, and for one other very important reason along the lines of the Commission of Inquiry, to let the Korean people living in the North know that we recognize what's happening and that we know who the criminals are. And so I think there could be great value in that, although all the cautions that Ken lays out are very important. I think what's really important is we've got to put together a deliberate strategy led by the Republic of Korea, supported by the international community, to target the regime.
We will go to Chad next, and then to Yono and Grace.
Chad O'Carroll from NK News. At the start, you talked about three models for understanding the North Korean leadership. I'm interested to know what you think the biggest flaws in the other two models are, why we shouldn't necessarily take those as reality. So the OGD and the idea that Kim Jong-un was, total power from day one. Thank you very much.
Okay. The first model about Kim Jong-un, this is a leader-based system, and that from day one he should be the leader. The only problem that I would have with that is the amount of time that he has had to be educated into the process of becoming supreme leader. Yes, he owns the power, he owns the titles, he is the ultimate decision maker. I believe all of that overlaps between the model that I have and that model. The only other question would be, being able to manipulate the levers of power in a way that is efficient for the supreme leader and his ability to bend the regime to his will. Again, I'm not saying that these other models are necessarily wrong. It's just that the lens that I developed, that would not make as much sense from what I have been seeing in the regime. That model doesn't fit completely like a glove. The OGD model I have a lot more trouble with. And that would assume that you have a bunch of individuals, primarily four first vice directors, although I think there are only three operating right now, that would be running the things behind the scenes. Now, there is no question, and I talk about the book about the proliferation of OGD people within the regime at the provincial level as well as the central level and other institutions. People who were in the OGD are now occupying. It does create this kind of mini mafia. I agree with that. But if you were to think about and take that model out to its logical extensions, there are two things that I think fall apart. One is that we have seen individuals from that model under Kim Jong-un suffer. They have been pushed aside. There is also some evidence that I believe, based on discussions that I've had with people, including inside the regime, that suggests that there are multiple patronage systems going into the OGD. It is not just tied directly to Kim Jong-un, it's tied to a variety of other people within the Kim family. And if you take that into case, it would suggest an OGD that is divided and potentially at odds with itself, as various members of the OGD have their own equities, and so it is not operating as a homogeneous organization. It is operating as, if that model were correct, that the that this is some sort of puppet master behind the scenes, you would think that there would be some much more strong, tight homogeneity there. The third part is that that model doesn't explain domestic and foreign policy. My sense is if that were the model that was operating, that what you would have is an intense focus, almost to the exclusion of everything else, on internal security. The idea of a charm campaign being manipulated in the outside world, the idea of whatever domestic policies that are being pushed forward, that would not happen under an OGD-run model. That would their primary focus is on surveillance of the regime. That's where the intense focus would be. And it doesn't explain a lot of what we're seeing now, I believe. So therefore, the model that I've put forward is done in such a way of looking at what we can observe from the outside. It's what I call residue analysis. And basically, you can't understand exactly what's going on behind the black curtain, but you can see residue of it, refracted light or whatever, of what may be going on by the policies that they're taking and things like that. And you're trying to develop a model where all of that kind of lines up and makes sense. And so that's the reason for my model. And again, it could be dead wrong, but at least that's the criteria that I use to try to set the model out. And then, of course, the whole idea of having a model for understanding a regime such as North Korea is that once you have a model, then you can see things happen, purges inside, policies there, whatever, and you can adjust your model. And then you can tweak your model. That's why I think when you study a regime, an authoritarian regime, a totalitarian regime, that if all you're going to do is studying it from the, as a state actor or as, one individual, Kim Jong-un, you're going to lose a lot, because you have to understand, I think, from the inside out, not the outside in order to understand how all of this kind of fits together and makes sense of what you're seeing. And there has not been one thing so far since Kim Jong-un has come to power that at least I can't explain away with the model. And as I say, it may not be right, may not be 100%, but at least it does explain what we're seeing in the outside world.
Thank you. We will have time for four more questions. Yono, Kim will be first, and then Dr. Cohen, Grace, and Peter Kung. And I think I see another question in the back. We'll take that as well. Yono, you're first, please.
Thank you. Yan Ho, USKI at SAIS. I have one quick question about market, private market activities and the regime stability. To what point do you think the regime will be tolerating the, booming private market activities? And do you see any clever maneuvering, if you will, by the regime, making sure the private market activities are supporting their Pyongyang policy, but not undermining their regime stability? And I'm not sure whether that this is related to this point, but what are the reasons you think that next two to 5 years are very critical time frame? Thank you.
If you take a look at the history of the markets, going back to 2000 and stuff, obviously North Korea tried to push back against the markets. I think that is over with. I think they have now made the decision that the markets are a vital part of the economy to support, the fact that the central, distribution system in North Korea is pretty much dead. And they need to have some way to really kind of provide for the people. That's one part of it. Two, probably more important, is they have figured out a way to make money off the markets. And by providing, taking basically skimming taxes and allowing people to have stalls in the markets and things like that, and they're taking basically their cut. That then provides, stuff that would go, and I suspect a percentage of that ends up into the royal economy, although I think most of it goes into the people's economy, and but there is a segment of it that does go into the regime in helping to satisfy the regime regime stability. Then I think that the one thing that they're most concerned about the markets, obviously, is the proliferation of information making it inside into the market and then beginning to then proliferate throughout North Korea. But my suspicion is, while they're cracking down a lot on this, that North Korea is beginning to make accommodations about information getting into the regime. They are building in the flexibility that will be needed to deal with the implications of this information getting into the regime. I think they've probably made a decision, the whole idea of cell phones and having cell phones and things like that, that they have made a decision that they are willing to accommodate a certain amount of information getting into the regime. And I think that they have taken measures to be able to control that and monitor it. But you know, it's not a black and white situation that is going to basically, you know, all of this stuff coming into the markets is going to lead to the regime getting rid of or trying to get rid of the markets. I think they have pretty much made the decision that the markets are here to stay, and then now they need to figure out how to accommodate them in some way. As far as the 2 to 5 year time frame, you know, that was, I must say, was something that really kind of surprised me when I did this study, is because when I went to Korea and Japan and China and talking to people inside, outside the regime and stuff, the time frame 2 to 5 years kept coming up again and again and again. Nobody could really kind of put a finger on why, but I think the idea is that there is an assumption that you know, if he cannot do what he needs to be able to consolidate the power and the economic dynamics going on in the regime, that it could create some sort of a perfect storm inside the regime within about that time frame, that it's going to make it very difficult for the regime to continue along the way that it has always done since 1946, or at least since the 1970s, where you basically had the institution of the supreme leader really kind of locked down. So the 2 to 5 years, I mean, I wouldn't put too much on that being, you know, cast in stone, but I think it's a good time frame in which to think about dynamics that are going, that the pieces of the puzzle are already in place, to think about the implications that they may have for regime stability. Those things are already in place now for the 2 to 5 year time frame. If we start to think out further, 10 years, 15 years, there are certain dynamics that are not even in place right now, or not even evident right now to even think about. So that's much more speculative.
Dr. Roberta Cohen. Roberta, can you please wait for the mic?
I like the image of a North Korean official on a plane reading Patrick Cronin's article, and it kind of led me to the COI report, and perhaps it would be a guess on your part, Ken, but that report came out in 2014, not only the report, but a letter from Michael Kirby to Kim Jong-un that speaks of his incurring personal criminal liability for what's going on in the country. Who do you think reads this? I don't mean by name, but within the regime, I mean, obviously the North Korean missions at the UN and Geneva read this whole report and the letter. And then there are other officials that are sitting on planes and maybe in embassies around the world who may have access to reading this. Back in Pyongyang, who gets to read the whole 300-page report, do you think? Mm-hmm. I mean, various policies came up. I mean, they denounced the report, they issued their own human rights report, they had a charm offensive vis-a-vis some human rights officials. There was a lot of back and forth. There's still to-ing and fro-ing, because the consequences of the report continue in the UN. How does that play out, do you think? How many people get to read that or see this? Is that a shocker for them? And particularly the young people you talk about, the younger people who are now part of Kim Jong-un's coterie.
In 2004, I wrote a paper on, it was a chapter in a book on North Korean elites in which I talked about information proliferation within the elite and how it worked, at least under Kim Jong-il, or at least how I thought it worked. And I think some similarities still hold true. The critical thing for thinking about, in terms of if you think about leadership dynamics in any country, is how to pierce the bubble to get inside to actually impact thought, or at least get some sort of reaction to whatever you publish or disinformation program that you want to send in, or it's like sending a virus into an organism. You first have to identify what the pathways are. And that pathways most likely, in the case of North Korea, are going to be an external pathway, then making it inside to the regime. So the UN mission or an embassy or something like that, picking up the document. We do know that in the past that anything written on the Kim family would be translated and sent into the regime. Usually traveling along SSD lines, which would be the internal secret police lines, would probably also touch the OGD as well. But the thing is, then it makes it into the regime. And then the question is, does that piece of information, article, book, piece of information, how does it then make it into the inner circle? And that's where it becomes very complex, because then it becomes a piece of information that can be hijacked and used for purposes inside the regime to, cause mischief within a, factionalized competition, so on and so forth. So it really depends on what the information is, what it's about, that sort of thing. Eventually, it's going to make it through probably the OGD into the personal secretariat, and there's a section within the personal secretariat that probably would then would take it, look at it, and make sure whether it's worthy of being passed on up the chain or whatever. Highly unlikely that Kim Jong-un would read something, anything that would be seen as detrimental, criticizing him personally. I mean, that's just not, if you think about the system, nobody wants to give the boss bad news. And but what you're possibly doing is introducing that system of thought into the system, which then will have to deal with it. Either lock it in a safe, it goes away, burn it, get rid of it, or possibly at some point, maybe they begin to think about it or look at it and take it seriously or talk about it. But again, when you're talking about a regime that is highly monitored, I mean, this is a police state on steroids. When if you have three people together, most likely one of them is an informant. Think about that. And imagine then putting yourself then not only in amongst the population, but somebody in the inner circle or somebody in the elite. That must be even more intensely surveilled. So then you ask, how does that proliferate without taking a lot of risk upon yourself? Well, it really depends, again, as we talk about stability. The more stable the regime, the harder it's going to be to proliferate that. As it becomes more shaky and people feel a little bit of comfort, I think this is probably part of the reason, and I won't go into it, but part of the reason why we've seen some purges over the last couple of years is because of the need to reassert stability inside the regime. That if it becomes a little wobbly, then maybe the stuff starts to begin to percolate out to within the elite sectors. And there are mechanisms that I talk about in that 2004 thing about how it could proliferate out. And potentially it could have some impact.
I know we have more questions, and unfortunately, we're almost out of time. Our speakers will spend some time. Dr. Miller, P. Peter, Grace, and Eun-jung, maybe they can spend a few more minutes talking to you. If not, please email me the questions, executive.director@hrnk.org, and I will facilitate the exchange. If participants have any questions about today's program or the book, please do the same. Please remember to friend us on social media. But before we conclude, I would like to give an opportunity to our discussants to make some final comments. Patrick?
Booker, just a final thought, really, on this last issue of the flow of information and the stoppage of information in and out of North Korea. I was struck by the very close scrutiny that the family reunion participants had going into North Korea. Not a big surprise, but I think the delays were even longer than previously. suggesting at least that superficially that the, you know, that the regime is more worried than ever about what can seep into North Korea. And despite those attempts on the interior forces of North Korea, they can't really win. They can't really stop the seepage of information. I think this book is, again, a testament to the fact that in 2015, we know a lot more about North Korea than we knew in when they were negotiating, when Bob Gallucci was negotiating the Great Framework. I think we know a lot more about this regime for all of the caveats and the questions. And I just think the information flow and the tide is against this regime, which is why I think the next 2 to 5 years is a very interesting time frame that you can't really think about a long-term future with security in North Korea right now. It may happen, there may be no letting, but there's more and more potential for sudden change and for other change or a sharp change of course.
Thank you. Dave?
I'd just like to say that this book is very useful for anybody who wants to think about strategy in North Korea. I mean, if you want to have balanced and coherent ends, ways, and means, we know the end ultimately is unification to end the nuclear program and stop the crimes against humanity. But the ways and means that you can do that can be drawn out of this book, as well as understanding the threats, the risks, and the opportunities. So for those who are thinking about policy and particularly strategy, this book helps you think about the human domain, which is critical to understanding and to developing strategy and policy. And so I can't commend this strongly enough.
Well, before we conclude, a very brief note, Patrick. Yes, we have had our way with titles, North Korean House of Cards. Remember that our report on abductions, Taken, was published before the Liam Neeson movie. Maybe you should consider North Korean Game of Thrones, North Korean Boardwalk Empire. My colleagues even tell me that they've developed an interest in Spartacus. On that note and on a serious note, we are almost ready to publish our next report, Pyongyang Republic, by none other than Bob Collins. Robert Collins, the author of our Songbun report on North Korea's social classification system. I would like to thank all of those who attended today for being with us today. Once again, if you have any questions about the book or about the program, please direct them to executive.director@hrnk.org. That is my email. And please do join me in thanking our distinguished panelists for today's program. Thank you very much.